by Penguin.
The Garden Party and Other Stories by Katherine Mansfield, read by Bonnie Wright.
If you're coming to this Penguin classic for the first time, then we'd recommend that you skip the introduction for now and return to it later, as it contains details of the plot. Please skip forward to chapter one now if you'd rather not listen to the introduction yet.
Introduction. Fables and fairy tales are age-old and used to be passed around by word of mouth. But short stories are a modern invention and reflect something of the loneliness of the acts of writing and reading. With the modernist movement in the early years of the 20th century, the form took on a particularly obsessive character, and writers like Katherine Mansfield and James Joyce and D.H. Lawrence made short stories into intensely crafted and evocative objects on the page, sometimes with nearly no plot at all in the conventional sense. Katherine Mansfield put even more into the story form than her contemporaries, however, since it was really her only form. She sometimes regretted this. She joked that Jane Austen's novels made modern episodic people like me look like very incompetent ninnies, and said to an old friend, sadly, at the end of her life, that all she'd produced were little stories like birds bred in cages. But her very dissatisfaction feeds into her stories and gives them a special edge. And in any case, her pleasure in the form is clear. She felt at home in it, being so little at home anywhere else. She left well-to-do New Zealand society behind in 1908, at the age of 19, but she remained something of an outsider in English literary circles. Her contacts with people she met were eager, tense, competitive, and mutually mistrustful. Most women in this world were helpmeets, or patrons, or muses, or mistresses, not artists in their own right, as she wanted to be. And even in literary Bohemia, the old social distinctions died hard. She was a colonial, and her banker father was a self-made man, so that she fitted all too well into a certain ready-made, snobbish stereotype. Provincial trade. It's possible to recapture something of the impact she made on English sensibilities by looking at her relations with the one major woman writer she knew well, Virginia Woolf. Their on-off friendship was marked by conflicting feelings of alienation and intimacy. A diary entry by Woolf for 1917, after she and Leonard had had Mansfield to dinner, reads, "We could both wish that one's first impressions of K.M. was not that she stinks like a well-civet cat that had taken to street walking. In truth, I'm a little shocked by her commonness at first sight, lines so hard and cheap. However, when this diminishes, she is so intelligent and inscrutable that she repays friendship." Even if you make allowance for Woolf's habitual private savagery, this passage shows what a powerful physical presence Mansfield had. Pioneering Mansfield scholar and biographer Anthony Alpers was puzzled by Woolf's overreaction. Catherine, he said in his 1980 Life, liked expensive French perfume, and dressed very well for that matter. Perhaps the Woolves thought it vulgar to wear scent at all. Alpers concluded that it must have been Mansfield's passion for the life of the senses that offended Woolf's sensitive nose. He was putting it too mildly. That civet reference is to the secretions of the musk glands of a cat, once upon a time an ingredient for making scent. Woolf was probably thinking of Shakespeare's As You Like It, where Bawdy Touchstone explains, Act 3, Scene 2, that sweet-smelling courtiers who use civet aren't as clean as they seem, because civet is of a baser birth than tar, the very uncleanly flux of a cat. Put the implications together, and Woolf is saying, with a sort of fascinated disgust, that Mansfield is like a tomcat marking out its territory, and at the same time, a she-cat on heat. And of course, the social and sexual messages are mixed up, too, so that the lines of her personality seem hard and cheap, yet in the next sentence she's transformed into someone intelligent and inscrutable, a new kind of aloof and attractive cat who has an inner life. This was a sentiment Woolf repeated in a diary entry of 1920. She is of the cat kind, alien, composed, always solitary and observant. When she thought of Mansfield in this way, Wolf felt very close to her. We talked about solitude, and I found her expressing my feelings as I never heard them expressed. She felt, she said, a queer sense of being like, not only about literature. To no one else can I talk in the same disembodied way about writing. And Mansfield wrote to her in a letter of that same year, "You are the only woman with whom I long to talk, work." Looking back in 1931, some years after Catherine's death, Virginia wrote to Vita Sackville West, "I thought her cheap, and she thought me priggish, and yet we were both compelled to meet simply in order to talk about writing. She had, as you say, the zest and the resonance. I mean, she could permeate one with her quality, and if one felt this cheap scent in it, it reeked in one's nostrils." It's as though, as soon as she thinks about Mansfield, even 8 years dead, she catches that shocking feral smell on the air, of the sexual adventuress, the stray cat, so disturbing because they shared the same dedication to writing. Catherine was a rival writer, not someone's girlfriend. Wolf liked, as she said, to talk about work in a disembodied way, but Mansfield's body wasn't so easily dismissed. We know how she struck another rival writer and sometime friend, too, for D.H. Lawrence based the character of Gudrun in Women in Love, at least in the part on Mansfield. In the spring of 1916, Lawrence, Frieda, Catherine, and her lover, later husband John Middleton Murray, had rented next-door cottages in Cornwall. They lived in great emotional closeness, too. Catherine, in a letter to a mutual friend, Kotliansky, famously provided an eyewitness account of one of Lawrence's murderous rows with Frieda. Suddenly Lawrence made a kind of horrible blind rush at her. He beat her to death, her head and face and breast, and pulled out her hair. And the even more horrid spectacle, she implies, of their reconciliation afterwards. Next day, whipped himself, and far more thoroughly than he had ever beaten Frieda. He was running about, taking her up her breakfast in bed and trimming her a hat. Lawrence, Claire Tomalin argues in her biography of Mansfield, A Secret Life, 1987, made Gudrun very like Catherine in general. Gifted artistically, charming, spirited, a good talker, a bit of a feminist, a bit of a cynic. Page 151. As well as putting actual incidents from the period of their friendship into the novel. By the time Women in Love was finished, she and Murray had disappointed Lawrence by refusing to fit into his plans, particularly Murray, with whom he imagined making a male bond of brotherhood. Claire Tomalin suggests, though, gruesomely but plausibly, that the real blood bond, Blutbruderschaft, was the one Lawrence formed unknowingly with Catherine. He may have infected her with the tuberculosis that killed her, since he was already suffering from the disease, though he died later than she did. Wolf and Lawrence, in their very different ways, reflect the force of Catherine Mansfield's personality, her gift for closeness and her sly separateness too. She was an object of speculation and gossip and jealousy, and she often gave as good as she got. The philosopher Bertrand Russell, with whom she flirted in 1916, wrote that her talk was marvelous, especially when she was telling of things she was going to write. But when she spoke about people, she was envious, dark, and full of alarming penetration. The Autobiography of Bertrand Russell, Volume 2, London, 1963, page 27. The hostility to her as a species of adventuress was very real. You can, though, catch more inward and tender glimpses of her in the work of her contemporaries. Tomlin points out that Lawrence's portrait of Gudrun includes passages which peer inside her head when she lies sleepless in the night, as Catherine often did. Conscious of everything, her childhood, her girlhood, all the forgotten incidents, all the unrealized influences, and all the happenings she had not understood, pertaining to herself, to her family, to her friends, to her lovers, her acquaintances, everybody. It was as if she drew a glittering rope of knowledge out of the sea of darkness. Woman in Love, Chapter 24. If this is Catherine, she must have talked eloquently to Lawrence about her past, telling of things she was going to write. For as time went by, she did indeed turn for inspiration more and more to the world she had left behind, across a sea of darkness, the New Zealand of her childhood and adolescence. In this collection, in fact, nearly half of the stories have a New Zealand setting, including the garden party itself, and At the Bay, which has the pride of place as the opening story. It is appropriate that At the Bay comes first, along with Prelude, 1917, collected in her earlier book, Bliss and Other Stories, and The Aloe, a longer, messier, earlier version of Prelude. It represents Katherine Mansfield's fragmentary and extraordinarily vivid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.